I hope you will recognize that the 1 and 1.5 hours that we have spent on presenting the story of the economic and social status of different social groups is helpful before we go to the solution which was given by Dr. Ambedkar sometime in 1947 or 50. Now, let us look at the Ambedkar solution. Now, we have seen that from the earlier discussion, that earlier presentation, we could identify two problems. One is the problem of economic inequalities which result into high poverty. Now, this is the problem of all, scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, OBC, higher caste, everybody. The only thing that the proportion of the poor or the magnitude of the poverty varies across the caste. It is higher among scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, followed by OBC, higher caste. It's also higher among the Muslims. So one problem is economic inequality and poverty, malnutrition. The other problem is the caste inequality, which is specific to Dalit. To certain extent, it also lower OBC also face discrimination. Women face discrimination. So these are the dual problems that we have to address. Now, Dr. Ambedkar addressed three issues. Which economic system will help us to address the problem of poverty and economic inequalities in state and minority? Second, which social system we need? Do we need the system which will promote equality, justice, fraternity? Because there are defenders of caste. You have to see some literature. They still believe that caste system is reasonably good. Then what strategies we require for social proper social system? How do we achieve them? What political instrument we used? What political system will help us to deal with the problem of economic inequality and social inequality as a means for transformation? These are the three questions, broadly speaking, which Dr. Ambedkar, second slide, try to address in the state and minorities. Now, as I said in my earlier presentation, Dr. Ambedkar started his effort to deal with the problem of former untouchable in 1990s. Of course, he has started writing much earlier. You know, when he was a student in Columbia University, he wrote an essay on caste in India, you may be knowing. That was a theory of caste. Then he wrote another paper. He reviewed the book by Bertrand Russell, Reconstruction of Society. And then there is another article on the remedies of small farmer. And in discussing the remedies of small farmer, he laid down the theory of economic development. I have written in my book. These were some of the academic writing of Dr. Ambedkar when he wrote memorandum to the South Bureau Committee in 1990 as a solution strategy. But that went on up to 1956. He formed three political parties. First political party was Independent Labour Party. And he was asked a question that when Communist Party of India was there in Dange, and Dange was in Bombay, and Dange and Randhiwe were the stalwart, very prominent leader in Bombay, why do you need an Independent Labour Party? There he gave a justification. So you have to see that. Then that was converted into a scheduled caste federation in 1948. Then finally into the Republican Party. So the memorandum and manifesto of these political parties also gives his thought, his views on the problem of labor, problem of economic system, problem of poverty, landlessness, caste discrimination. So you can also pick up from it. But putting all it together, all the statement he made, a memorandum he submitted, other writings, political manifesto and all that, you find his thinking culminated into State and Minority of 1947. And then we have his one of his very celebrated article, speech after 1947, that was in Kathmandu, Buddha and Karl Marx. There also you can see his thinking on the development. Please go ahead, second. Now let us come to State and Minorities. As I share with you, State and Minority was a memorandum that he submitted to the Constituent Assembly, and he wanted that to be made a part of the Constitution. And what does that include? That includes the solution against economic exploitation for all, not for Dalit alone. So remedies against economic exploitation, that's the actual wording in the book. It's not strategy or solution, remedies against economic exploitation, remedies against discrimination, and then separately, that remedies against discrimination also include remedies against minorities, religious minorities, as well as the woman. And then there is a special section on remedies against discrimination of scheduled castes. That is how the State and Minority is framed. But there is one point that you remember, that the State and Minority is in the form of a constitution. He thought that instead of just writing a small memorandum or a book, he prepared it in the form of a constitution, so it was a draft of the constitution, as it were. And I think Ambedkar was the only person who prepared that draft. And that talk about unification of the state, that talk about fundamental rights, that talk about executive, judiciary and other things. So he had developed a draft of constitutions in the form of constitution. There are articles there, you must go and see, and then there are appendixes. And in that then, what are the remedies and protection for the minorities and the scheduled caste and the scheduled tribe and others. So if Ambedkar was made a member of the Constituent Assembly, and subsequently, if he was made a chairman of the draft committee, it was not just like that. They discovered that he had the only reasonable idea as to what should be the constitution of India, and that was State and Minority. It was internally circulated in Fundamental Rights Committee also, before it was published. But there is another reason that I want to share with you, is that he was involved in constitution making right from 1919. As I told you, we were ruled by the Government of India Act of 1810. And there was a provision that this act will come for a modification after every 10 years, and Indians' opinion will be sought. Therefore, when the first opinion was sought in 1919, and when Ambedkar was in Bombay, he gave him a memorandum. In 1929, when Simon Commission came, 10 years down the letter, he gave him a memorandum. Roundtable conference, second, first, and then 35 Act. He played a very, very important role in each of these. Modifications came after every 10 years. He had a significant role in Roundtable Conference in London. He was a member of Minority Committee and several committees, and the Prime Minister of Britain saw his role. Gandhiji saw his role, his value. So it is not just like that member of the Drafting Committee and Chairman of the Drafting Committee. They knew that he is a person with knowledge. But he submitted the State and Minority. That was his vision for the upliftment of the masses in the country. Two solutions. Economic exploitation, remedies against economic exploitation, remedies against social discrimination. Now, I did not spend time on fundamental rights. They are laid down in the State and Minority, which are there also part of the Constitution. But I'll discuss only briefly. What are his remedies against economic exploitation? What are his remedies against social discrimination? And what are his remedies particularly with respect to scheduled caste? He began to use the word scheduled caste because in 1935 Act referred scheduled caste. But before I go to the actual provision in the State and Minorities, let us go a little ahead. and see the link and what was in his mind. You know that the professors, Babu Matthew, Jaffet and all lawyers and professors would know that the Nehru Committee was set up. And Nehru Committee's task was, in the Constitutional Assembly, was to let down the aims and objective of our Constitution. Constitutional Assembly was set up, Constitution was to be made and framed, but with what goal and objective we should make? Should we make it a Hindu state? Should we make it a communist economy or socialist economy? Or should we have a private economy with parliamentary democracy? What should be the goal? Should we promote economic equality, social equality, or we should go other way around? So the objective were to be let down. Therefore, Nehru Committee was set up. Very prime committee. Prime Minister Nehru was the chairman of that committee and they laid down the aims and objective. The first meeting of the Constitutional Assembly was on the aims and objective. Everybody had to agree that these are the goal, and to realize those goals, we will make our constitution. And that report came for aims and objective Nehru Committee came for a discussion. Everybody spoke. Ambedkar also spoke. And there lies the roots of the state and minority also. Ambedkar spoke. And that was a very celebrated speech of Ambedkar, which bring a friendly relationship between Congress and him. And Congress thought that he can be a compromising person and we can make use of it. There is a background to this, of course, but I would not like to go into that. But he criticized Nehru's resolution on aims and objective. Because on two grounds, understand please, that issue is still today. And that is the issue why we are here and you are here. That Nehru resolution talks about economic equality, freedom, justice for everybody. Economic equality, social equality, fundamental rights, and justice. So what is the goal of the Constitution? We should let down the provision in the Constitution in a manner such that it will promote economic equality, social equality, justice. Individual freedom. Perfectly fine objectives. But Ambedkar has one objection, and that objection was, he said that you are laying down the rights of economic equality, of equality, equal status, social justice, but where are the remedies? Rights have no meaning without remedies. Rights are only pronouncement. But unless you give the solution, what will happen? And I want to read for you what he said verbatim. I am picking up some sentences from his speech while commenting on Nehru resolution. Rights are nothing unless remedies are provided. Rights without remedies has no use to the people. Rights are real only if they are accompanied by remedies. That's why he used the word remedies there. Then this is his comment when Nehruji and everybody was sitting there, whole Constituent Assembly as it were, was sitting, Rajendra Prasad was sitting chairing. Friends, I should have expected some provision whereby, I am picking up the last paragraph, I should have expected some provision whereby it would have been possible for the state to make economic, social and political justice a reality. And I should have expected resolution to state, that was Nehru resolution, to state in most explicit term that in order that there may be social and economic justice in the country, there should be nationalization of industry and nationalization of land. I do not understand how it could be possible for any government which believe in doing justice socially, economic and politically, unless his economy is socialistic economy. So roots of state socialism, which he proposed later, I'll discuss with you, lies in his very first comment. He was not scared of mentioning that because he thought that Nehru is a socialist of a type, that it is possible that they might have some socialistic economy incorporated in the constitutions. But Ambedkar did not put that as a condition. He said, we should have a socialist economy. But he said, I leave that issue there. That was the compromise of Dr. Ambedkar, which some of the people said. I leave that issue there and we should proceed further. Then he goes and talk about other issues. But in state and minority, he opened up his mind. What socialism he want, what economic system he want, what social system he want, and what political system he want to realize that economy and society. Now, let me then begin with... Okay. Now, let us come to the economic equality. Let us come to the remedies against economic exploitation. Now, Dr. Ambedkar took a position, please understand, in his original form. Dr. Ambedkar took a position that can we remove economic inequality? You have seen the causes of poverty of Dalits are landlessness, lack of capital. They don't have access to resources, which are the main source of income. He raised the question, can the private economy, based on capitalism, deal with the problem of poverty and economic equality? His answer to the question was no. Let me read you again. Socialization is essential for rapid industrialization. Private enterprise cannot do it. If it did, it will produce inequalities of wealth which private capitalism has produced in Europe. Now, consolidation of landholding, tenancy legislations are worse than useless. Land reform. Neither consolidation nor tenancy legislation can solve the problem of the resourceless person. Only collective farms on the line set out in the proposal can be helped. So there should not be any illusion that Dr. Ambedkar was in favor of the private economy or private economy based on private ownership of means of resources. He wanted the nationalization of land, public sector in key industries, and other things. Now, what is the solution? So Ambedkar is close to Marx. Insofar as he talks about socialist economy, he is drawing from the Marx. He criticized private economy. That private economy based on private ownership of capital will produce inequality. Therefore, he suggested the socialistic economy of a type. He didn't suggest the economy altogether similar to that of Soviet Union or early China, early communist China. But he suggested a socialist economy. What is that economy? Ambedkar proposed state socialism. He used state socialism word in an important field of economic life. State socialism involves state ownership in agriculture with a collectivized method of cultivation. So as far as agriculture is concerned, he was of the firm opinion, land reform, that is putting limit on ownership of land to ceiling, tenancy and consolidation of holding will not help Dalit, simply because Dalit and others, because high caste landlord will not allow the land reform to be successful. That is what precisely has happened. Ceiling on land, Dalit did not get land to ceiling on holding. It is the OBC who benefited, because they had money to go to the court and fight their cases and get the land. Dalit could not fight. If the land distributed under the ceiling to the Dalit is extremely small. Tenancy, every high caste do not lease out the land in a big significant way to the Dalit. A very small proportion of them are tenant. Therefore, he opposed tenancy and opposed ceiling land holding and consolidation of holding and nationalization of land. He said, what is the use of this land reform for Dalit, where they will not be allowed to get the surplus land? So nationalize the land, distribute them equally, and go for a collective farm. If not for a collective farm, go for a private farm, but with everybody having land, which is the situation today in China. The land is private, nationalized, but land is given to every family depending on the number of the person in the family. So that was the only solution he visualized. And the other solution of land reform, he opposed, and you can see that how Ambedkar was right. But Marxist, socialist did not support him. I am not talking of Marxist. Manu Misani was the first one to oppose this. I'll come to that later. What about industry? He proposed a modified state socialism in the field of industry, where he said key and basic industry should be with the government. Close to Nehru's model and our model that we have followed. Basic and key industry with the government, insurance with the government, education with the government, health with the government. That was his concepts of state socialism. Nationalization of land and cultivation of land through collective farm, basic and key industry with the government, so that people get employment, surplus generated through private public sector undertaking, it can be invested again for the people. And nationalization of insurance, everybody should have insurance, everybody should have education, everybody should have health. So he keep that with the government sector. That was the concept of socialism of Dr. Ambedkar. Does it vary significantly from what has happened in Russia or China at that time? Not much. He only leave the small industrial sector with the private. So he draw much of his ideas on economic system from Marx, but not fully accepted. Now, this is the economic remedy of Ambedkar. Now, you can relate it with, I'll come to the actual problem in Karnataka and relate the solution by Ambedkar. Now, let us come to the second remedy. What are the remedies against the discrimination? Now, here he differ from Marxist and socialist. Had he been the traditional Marxist, he would not have suggested the remedies against social discrimination. Because what is the traditional Marxist line of thinking? That superstructure like caste, religion is determined by economic structure. Ownership of property determine the social structure, determine the religious ideology, determine the state even, of course. Therefore, once your economic structure is socialist, the superstructures will wither away. The problem will be problem of social inequality, gender inequality will be already taken care of. That was the classical Marxist position, which remained today. Even. There is not much change. There is a change now. I have given two lectures. In my invitation was from Communist Party of India on reservation in private sector. Twice I gave. There is a big conference in Delhi on Ambedkar and his relevance by CPIM in the Constitution Hall, and I am a keynote speaker, 19th of September. Things have changed. But again, the things are in the process of understanding only. So the classical Marxist position is that you take care of economic structure, being equalization of economy, social economics, social inequality will be automatically taken care of. Please understand this issue. But Ambedkar did not believe that way. Ambedkar believed that yes, caste has an economic foundation. Please distribute quickly. Yeah. Give them here in the front. There are people. Give them. No, it's okay. Take 1 minute. Here. Hello. Here. So, why Ambedkar suggests the additional remedies against social discrimination? And for the scheduled caste, the reason is that his views was that equalization of economic opportunity will take care of the problem to a greater extent. Not that he didn't deny. All social inequality, that is because of economic inequality. You are treated discriminated and you are harassed because you are landless, dependent on high caste. The moment you get a land and you are independent, quite a few social discrimination goes down. But it does not eliminate it altogether. Because the roots of many of these social discrimination are in caste system or Hindu social ideology, and sometimes in religion. There are religious principles which justify the caste system. You know, caste system is a divine origin. Caste is not created just like that. It's a divine origin, as for the Hindu philosophy, Hindu religious philosophy. Brahmin came from the mouth, Kshatriya came from the arm, Shudra, Vaishya came from the knee, Shudra came from the feet of the god. And the god decides the rights and duties of each one of them. It's a divine origin. So it has a religious root. It doesn't have a root in capitalism or feudalism. So you have to deal with those roots of social discrimination and caste discrimination to the extent they are determined by the ideology. Now this also brings division among the worker. The Marxists would say, Marx has said that there is a proletariat fraternity. All are poor. All are exploited by the capitalist and the feudal lord. So there is a brotherhood, there is a fraternity. They have one emotion. And so they will come together. They will form the party and they will undertake revolution and change the system. Ambedkar raised the question in caste, annihilation of caste. That the proletariat are not uniform here. They are economically uniform but socially not uniform. And social distinctions are so strong that they are divided on caste line. They might join unitedly in a demonstration of the worker for a higher wage. But when they come back, they have different locality. They have less interaction. They don't intermarry. They discriminate. In a village, the landless worker from the OBC and the higher caste live separately and the untouchable live separately. And he doesn't invite, he or she doesn't invite proletariat. Poor OBC doesn't invite him inside the home or have an inter-caste marriage. No, division is there. So what kind of fraternity and brotherhood will be developed between the poor from the high caste and poor from the Dalit? That division comes in. That's why Ambedkar says that you have to remove this distinction. He also went further and argued that what kind of unity you can have between the poor belonging to the high caste and poor belonging to low caste. If the poor now, who are a member of the Communist Party, poor Dalit and poor high caste, who are a member of the Communist, Socialist or whatever party, they only come for a limited purpose and then they stay separately. So Dalit won't have a confidence in them that after the revolution, when there is economic equalization, we will get the same treatment. Because of that suspicion, they are reluctant to join the front. They face discrimination now. They suspect that discrimination will be there even after revolution, which is the case. That happened in Mao's China. That happens here. The scheduled caste and scheduled tribe and other employee in public sector undertaking, government undertaking, scheduled caste face discrimination. So what is the guarantee that after the socialization comes in, socialism comes in, untouchable will not continue to suffer discrimination by the hand of the so-called high caste poor and proletariat there? So he raised the question that the caste, you will have to deal with it. These are the issues. Some of them, they stretch this issue too far. But while Ambedkar has a close similarity with Marx in the sense that like Marx, he proposed Marxist notion of socialist economy. That similarity we have to understand. There are some who criticize this aspect of Marx unnecessarily. We have to recognize quite clearly that Ambedkar was a socialist. His differences comes in the means. He was a democratic socialist. That I will come later on. But let us accept first fact that he was a socialist of a sort, of a kind. And that kind was nationalization of land, nationalization of basic and key industry, insurance, education, health, rest of the sector in private. That was socialist economy he was talking about. Socialist economy is a Marxist concept. Or Fabian socialist or democratic socialist. It doesn't matter, but origin is in Marx. So that has to be accepted. But having accepted that, one has also to be accepted the limitation of a Marxist ideology. That The social issue of discrimination will not be eliminated altogether because of economic equalization. It will still remain, so it has to be addressed separately, independently, to which the high caste proletariat should support. Now that is why he has given the remedies against discrimination separately in that very book. Let us go to those remedies. What are those remedies? He has analyzed the caste system very carefully. I don't want to spend too much of time on this. That you know caste system. That caste system is a division of people into five categories and several of sub-castes, but basically five castes. People are grouped into certain groups called caste. Then they are made exclusionary group by introducing the concept of endogamy, that each of these caste group will marry within the caste, so you are separate then, separate and exclusive. But caste also allocate rights to each of these caste. So some high caste have more right and middle caste have less right, and untouchable at the bottom of the caste hierarchy have much less right, practically no right to untouchable. In fact, they are considered to be inferior being, polluting. Since they are inferior being and polluting, they are socially and physically segregated. In Manusmriti, they should be living separately, they should have social separation, high caste should not have association with them. So you can see Manusmriti quite live in any village of Karnataka, insofar as the residences of untouchables are separate from that of a high caste. Poor and rich. It's not that the poor from the OBC and poor from the high caste stay with the low caste. No, caste division prevails irrespective of economic background. That's why Ambedkar says caste system is not division of labor, it's a division of laborer. So, untouchables suffer more than OBC in one respect, that they are untouchable. OBC are not considered to be polluting, but untouchables are considered to be polluting and impure. Therefore, their houses are separate, not OBCs. Or high caste. High caste and OBC more or less stay together, but untouchables are away from the high caste locality. So socially and physically segregated, and they don't have any access because they are inferior being. And by means are superior being. By making Brahmin superior being, there are ingredient of fascism. I'll take that issue in the answer question if you ask, because that's not the topic now. I hope the earlier speaker has covered in revolution and counter-revolution. How we talk about fascism, we say Hindu fascism and all that, but nobody is able to bring out what are those fascist elements, what are those philosophical elements in Hinduism which make the Hindu social order fascist, and which we see in the practice. I'll discuss that in the kitchen hour or so. Now, so caste system divide people, give right unequally and in an ungraded manner, and there are two things that you must remember of caste system. One, that it also provides an instrument for maintaining the caste system. Community level mechanism. And what is that? Social ostracism. Economic and social boycott. If the untouchable violate the customary norm, which are unconstitutional though, the high caste will punish them. And the high caste will punish not only the untouchable who deviate them, but they will also punish their own caste people who violate caste system. If an OBC girl or a boy married an untouchable girl, the boy is punished, their own boy is punished. Untouchables are punished, that's another matter, but even OBC is punished. So, mechanism of social ostracism. So, the high caste act as a police force at their own level. And that police force is very strong than the normal police force. Customary rules are maintained. Nobody can courage to modify, to deviate from the normal customary norm in the villages. Because there is a police force there of high caste, which is informal police force. We have an act, Prevention of Atrocity Act, but we have to analyze the feature of the caste system. And second, fifth feature, which is very important, is that religion provides justification to the caste system. There are philosophical elements in the Hindu religion which provide justification. Caste system is a Hindu social organization, but it has also justification comes from the religion. What are those philosophical elements in Hinduism? First is caste is a divine origin. It's a religious principle. It's not social principle. Caste created by God. And Hindu believe in God, Brahma, Vishnu. And now, since the God has created the caste, and we believe the God, we also believe the caste. There are societies in the world where caste-like systems present, are observed. But those caste-like systems in other countries in the world have developed in the course of the history, through the historical process. They are not the product of the religion. Our religion had not supported them. Once the Anti-Slavery Act was passed in USA, slavery disappeared within 50 years or 30 years. You don't have traces of slavery in USA. We demolish untouchability. Untouchability is very life. Why? Ambedkar's explanation is the religious roots to untouchability. Christianity doesn't provide justification to untouchability, to slavery. It is a different matter that Christianity supports colonialism. Wherever colonialism went, missionary also followed and justified them. But there is nothing in the Bible which justifies slavery. So you can use Bible always to oppose slavery. But can you use Hinduism to oppose casteism and untouchability? No. Because there is justification. Theory of karma, theory of soul, theory of rebirth, all are used to justify caste system. What is the theory, Hindu theory of karma? Hindu theory of karma is that man dies but soul doesn't die. When man or a woman dies, the material body became the part of the universe. Your body became the part of the earth, your oxygen that you take is become the stock, merge into the stock of the air. Your temperature, once you became a cool, the heat goes to and became a part of the mass of the temperature. That is how your material element became the part of the already existing material. Nothing remains. That's the theory of Buddha. There is nothing other than body. But in Hinduism, no, there is a soul. Body dies, soul doesn't die. Soul is eternal. And the soul carries the impression of the deed that you did in your present work, life. If you did bad things, the soul carries. If you did a good thing, soul carries that impression. And your second birth is determined by the past deed through soul. How does that soul goes into the woman's body and take a rebirth? We don't know. But that is the theory. So your present birth is determined by the past. Okay? Now, in the present you are told that you are untouchable, you don't have this right. Follow the caste system, follow the karma of caste. But if you do a good thing, that is follow your caste rights and duties, serve the high caste, then you will get a better future, better birth, sorry. And that better birth means what? Your impression of your good deed, that is serving the high caste, will be carried by the soul and you get a better birth. So the Hindu theory of karma talks about the past and the present. It doesn't talk about the present. Talk about past and the future. It doesn't talk about the present. Buddha's theory of karma talks about present. Ambedkar put it into Buddha and his Dhamma. As you sow, so do you reap. Jaise boge, vaise phal milegi. So it gives you incentive that if you work hard, get a BA degree, get a MA degree, pass NET examination, you are likely to get a lecturership. So there is the incentive. If you do a law degree from this number one law university, you have a chance of getting a good job or become a good lawyer. This is the incentive Buddhist theory of karma gives you. Hindu theory of karma doesn't give you that incentive. Whatever you do good thing, the result of that good thing will be in the future, which you haven't seen. But justifying that you continue to do your present duties, which are caste-based duties, means justifying caste system. So, sorry, I'm taking more time on this. The last point is that there are elements of Hinduism, philosophical element which justify caste system. That is why breaking caste system is a lot more difficult. The ideological roots of casteism need to be dealt with. There is economic foundation to it, which we can deal that economic foundation to socialism. Marx is right there, Ambedkar is right there. But there are ideological roots which Ambedkar has argued, religious ideological root, that will have to be treated differently. There is a different policy necessary, which Marxists don't accept till recently. Now therefore, Ambedkar proposed the remedies of discrimination. Sorry, I had to give you long clarification on this as to why he proposed remedies, because that is an issue of confusion between the Marxists and the non-Marxists, and Dalit and the Dalit who talk about class and talk about caste. One has to understand it positively. One should not differ blindly. We must know the similarity and differences. We must know what Ambedkar has drawn from Marx, and which he disagree on, what issue he disagree with Marx, and what new proposal he has given. Then it will be in clarity. Now, what are the remedies against discrimination? The remedies against discrimination, of course, one of the remedies of his was that please disregard those religious principles of Hinduism and Hindu social order which promote inequality, injustice and infraternity. Not all of them, but those principles which supports inequality, injustice, and not promote brotherhood, bring miseries for those principles will have to be discarded. And therefore he talked that you can take them from Buddha, because Buddha talk about equality, fraternity, justice, opposed casteism, being rationality, there is no concept of God and all that. So he talk of ideological transformation from one ideology to another ideology. But we are not discussing that. That he didn't mention in State and Minority. That he mentioned in the Kathmandu lecture, Buddha and Karl Marx. But in State and Minority, he gave a program of discrimination, and that is, can you go ahead, please? Go ahead. This is the program that remedies against the discrimination. First is, of course, the legal safeguard. You know, if you look at the first memorandum that he submitted to the South Bureau Committee, the first remedy is that I have not included and he has not included, and that is equal civil citizenship right to the Dalit. Because Dalit were not given equal citizenship right at that time, in 1919. There were laws also. Laws against the equal right to the Dalit. Some of you can go and read South Bureau Committee's and Simon Commission memorandum. Ambedkar gave an example of a Mahar woman, Mahar untouchable woman from Bombay who was arrested. She was arrested for what? She was arrested for selling the watermelon. And the court said that untouchable cannot sell consumable good. Law. Police law. So therefore Ambedkar's first demand was equal citizenship right to the Dalit. And then second is the law, legal safeguard against discrimination. He omitted the equal civil right because Constitution has already accepted 35 Act. But the first remedy is you should have a law against untouchability and discrimination. You should have a law against gender discrimination. That is why he had that bill. What is it called? Woman. As a law minister, the bill that he introduced for the right of women was Hindu code. Hindu. So law against untouchability. So that at least at individual level, somebody discriminate you can go to the court of law. First solution. Second solution is that law by itself cannot give you the equal right in practice. And therefore, you may not get the share, you may not get in employment, you may not get in education institution, you may not get many other spheres. Because if you don't get access to the well or temple, which is a public temple, you can go to the court of law. But if a private employment do not give you an employment, he can justify that you are less meritorious. The other person is better than you. You may be better than him and you are discriminated. So you have less access to employment, less access to parliament if you don't have a reservation. Because our majority is a communal majority. We don't feel ashamed of openly talking about the caste majority and supporting on the basis of caste. Political parties and organizations making estimate in the election based on the caste number. These many are Jatavs, these many are Yadavs, these many are Shedulka, these many are Lingayat, these many are Devgowda, these many are Marathas. Openly. So Ambedkar said that the Indian majority is a communal majority. It is not a secular majority. And the classical example of that experience was Ambedkar himself. Ambedkar was a framer of the constitution. Ambedkar was a law minister, a towering man. Columbia University gave him a D.Litt degree in 1952. And he contested two Lok Sabha elections. One in Bombay and lost. Whom did he lose? Balu. Balu was a person from, was a cricketer. And Ambedkar felicitated him. But he then joined Congress and he was the scheduled caste candidate in a constituency, reserve constituency against Ambedkar, a small man. But he defeated. Why? Because all high caste supported Balu and not Ambedkar, despite the fact that he was a constitution framer. He lost. He stood again in Bhandara constituency. Again he lost. Why? Communal majority. Nobody respected Ambedkar's contribution to constitution. Or as a law minister, or as a towering leader, so-called Bharat Ratna in later on. So, if there is a communal majority, how can Dalit be elected in the various elections? So, therefore, Dalit may be underrepresented, as the Muslims are experiencing, women are experiencing. Men's constituency is also communal constituency, but by not putting as many women as a candidate and electing them. Therefore, he asked for safeguard against underrepresentation in legislation, in employment, in services, in education. I am not going into get a detail. Discrimination will make it impossible for the Dalit to get elected, to get a job in private sector and public sector, to get admission in education institution, to get access to other facilities. Therefore, reservation for a fair access is necessary. In addition to socialization, in addition to nationalization, this is the point I am making before you. This is the point that Ambedkar made. This is what the socialist and the Marxists have to understand. And many of them justify it. There are many of Marxists who have written article in support of reservation. But for the sake of clarity, I am bringing you as to why you need the remedies against social discrimination in addition to remedies against the economic discrimination and exploitation. But there are two things that I want to place before you, two, three things to indicate you and how Ambedkar was right in the present. Ambedkar also suggested remedies against, of course, boycott, social discrimination, but there are two things that I would like to particularly mention to you. And I don't understand it well. Maybe lecture I will talk to Babu Matthew and Zafed. I didn't understand it. I am an economist. He wanted, remember well, I underlined and listen carefully. He wanted safeguard against the legislature. He wanted the safeguard against the legislation itself. Because he thought that the legislature would be dominated by the high caste Hindu. And what is the guarantee that the legislature will always take right decision through parliament? Why the, how can, their legislation can also be communal? So he suggested safeguard against them. And one of the examples that he has given, that if you want to change the reservation policy, for example, through parliament, then a special session of the parliament should be called. And the reservation policy should be modified after 25 years or so through a 2/3 majority. But most important condition that he made was this, that all the scheduled caste MP who are under the reservation, 82 of them or 80, 2/3 of them should vote for or against. That is the safeguard. Because he didn't have a faith in the legislature dominated by the communal majority. I hope I am presenting, Baba Matthew, I hope I am presenting it meaningfully. The second point was, and that is what happening. There is no bill for reservation. Reservation is through the executive order. There was a bill made, and I had helped the forum for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe MPs. That bill ran into trouble and it is not passed. It is still with the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. Bill for the special component plan, which you have done, it's not passed. Bill of modified bill of atrocities, it is not passed. Legislature. So he wanted safeguard against the legislature themselves. Then he wanted, I forgot to tell you that in addition to the reservation in legislature, central, state and local, in employment, in education, in many jobs, he also wanted reservation in the executive. Executive means ministry, governance body. That there should be at least 2 to 3, 4, whatever schedule caste, ministers. And the argument he is constantly giving in a society which immensely discriminated against scheduled caste and untouchable on a day-to-day basis, how do we expect that on a one fine morning, because of political democracy, they will become secular? I am coming to the democracy aspect of it, because the topic is democracy. Okay, I'll take 10 minutes because we still get 1 hour for discussion. The last point was remedies against bureaucracy. You pass the law, you have a reservation, but it is the bureaucracy which implement it. And he had no faith in bureaucracy. He said what is required is the people talk about efficient governor, efficient bureaucracy, but what we require is the good bureaucracy. He draw a distinction between good bureaucracy and the and the efficient bureaucracy. Bureaucrat may be efficient, but he also can discriminate them. But to be a good bureaucrat, he should follow the rule. And that is what precisely happened now. The law of untouchability, you have 100 cases and conviction rate is 3.7. This is the outcome of the working of the judiciary, police and public prosecutor. There are several positions which remain underrepresented in the government. There are thousands of complaints made by the scheduled caste employees to the SCST commission that there are discrimination on the basis of caste, 11,000 something. 5 years before, when I wrote an article on Anna, Loka Ayukta Bill, I say put this condition also. 12,000, I asked this joint secretary in SCST commission, he said how many cases other than the atrocities and all that. He told me 12,000 cases by the government employee of discrimination. Bureaucracy is discriminatory. SCST component plan is not implemented. So you require a safeguard against the bureaucracy again. Now, one of the classical example of that safeguard now, how Ambedkar is true, is the legislation passed by the Andhra Pradesh government to enforce the implementation of the special component plan. Do you have that also in Karnataka? Why do you need that? There is executive order for the special component plan. Why do you need a law? The reason for being is that the bureaucrat do not practice it. Their own decision. So to implement their own decision, you require a law. Nowhere in the world. Once there is administrative guideline, administrative rule, bureaucrat is required to implement it. But here is a bureaucracy, because of the caste prejudice, does not implement, compelling the government to introduce, pass a bill and make it obligatory on the bureaucrat to implement it and also provide punishment. I don't know whether they are punishment provided. There is a law. Given the intensity of discrimination, Ambedkar at that time, 1947, visualized that you require a safeguard against the legislature, you require a safeguard against bureaucracy. How true and how foresight he has. Of course, Ambedkar foresight is everywhere, on every issue. Why Ambedkar is becoming meaningful? I'll come sometime and give a lecture to you. Because Ambedkar was not a leader of Dalit alone. He was a national leader on all issues that emerged between 1920 to 1955. Related to Dalit or non-Dalit, he wrote. He gave a solution. That is why he is relevant. Ambedkar is not quoted just like that. It is quoted because he has written. When the issue of minority in Pakistan came, he wrote a bulky book on thoughts on Pakistan. Ran into second edition within a year's time and gave the solution. When the reorganization of state took place and reorganization commission submit the report, he wrote another book opposing the reorganization of the suggested by the reorganization commission and gave his own plan. Small state. And this is what Ambedkar's plan is being used now. There were two state form in UP, Ambedkar's suggestions book. Telangana was form, Ambedkar's suggestions. This was a national issue, this was not a Dalit issue. And then economic development. We can talk about that some other time about economic development. So the point is that you do require safeguard against this. The last point I will mention, and I'll then go to the means and then stop, is that he also proposed the separate settlement of scheduled castes in the villages. Very revolutionary demand by him, because he thought that in the villages, which is a den of conservatism, untouchable would not get the citizenship right. And the reason that he gave was two reasons, which are very true even today. One, why atrocities? Why opposition by the high caste, OBC or higher caste? The reasons are two, that they are caste-ridden, they draw their sustenance from religious values, that's another matter, but they are in majority and that they are economically powerful. Dalits are in minority and economically dependent on high caste. So any education and right that Dalit want, they may not be able to enjoy. They are up against a group which are demographically majority and economically powerful. Therefore, he said, have a separate villages and settlement of Dalit, give them the land and break the economic nexus with the high caste. That is the word that he had used. So that you live separately, we live separately. So equal but separate. That is the kind of thing, the meaning that I can draw. And he wanted to set up a settlement officer to acquire the land, give the land for houses and also agricultural land. But that suggestion was not accepted. But the problem now persists. Why atrocities persist on scheduled castes? Why they are poor? Why exploitation? Because they are small in number in villages and they are dependent on high caste. So they are completely helpless. I have seen that. Therefore he emphasized industrialization and urbanization. He sees freedom and liberation in urbanization and industrialization. Because in cities and town, nobody talks about your caste background. But caste come into play in urban areas, in employment, in interpersonal behavior, in marriages, but not day-to-day oppression and suppression and humiliation that happens in villages. So he focuses on industrialization and urbanization. Now, separate settlement was another program of his. Finally, I come to a last point, and that is, how do you achieve this economic remedies against economic exploitation and social discrimination through state socialism and the social system based on not on caste but on equality of principle and this all measure that I have presented before you. Here he differ with Marxist. He has similarity with Marxist insofar as he draws concept of socialism, but he believe that it will have to be brought through the political system called parliamentary democracy. He believed in democratic principle very vehemently. And he raised this question to the Marxist scholar and others. Please read Buddha and Karl Marx lectures. The entire discussion about Soviet Union, China, and we were there. But I'll only make a couple of points. He believed that the dictatorship of proletariat, however good it is, and in fact he went a step ahead and said that I feel that dictatorship of proletariat is good for some time, but not for a long time. But ultimately he said that you cannot build sustained socialism on the strength of dictatorship. You have to convert people to be a part of socialism. They have to accept socialism in ideology and in practice it. It is the democratic acceptance, and conversion of ideas and values and acceptance that will sustain socialism. Therefore, he said that they should accept Buddhist principle. Socialism will be sustained not by force of proletariat and military, but it will be sustained by the voluntary acceptance by the people. So democracy and conversion of ideas and thoughts is the only durable solution to bring a socialism. Therefore, he suggested, and he was against the dictatorship of any kind, therefore he suggested very idealistic solution, and that solution was constitutional state socialism. That when you define political structure You know what are the constitution define? Liberal Western tradition of constitution is what? You define fundamental right and you define political structure. Isn't it? The economic policies are taken by the legislature through an ordinary decision in the house. Constitution only laid down fundamental right, others, and the political system and electoral system. But he said, no, we have to learn from the failure of the Western system. What we require that the constitution should not only define political system and structure, it should also define economic structure. To make the democracy work better. And that is why you know that. So he said that we should make socialism constitutional and unamendable by any government. Now, we have a political system, we have democracy. When there was an attempt to change the constitution, you recall that during the one particular government. Shanti Bhushan went to the Supreme Court and court gave an order, decision. You can change any aspect, but you cannot change the fundamental framework of the constitution. And fundamental right forms that. So if you cannot change the fundamental right and political structure, you can also make economic structure as a part of the constitution and make it unamendable by any government. So that you establish socialism by constitution and that democracy which is based on economic equality and social equality will be durable. Therefore, his last statement, last speech in the Constituent Assembly which he gave is quoted by everybody. That we are entering into a sphere of contradiction, period of contradiction. That in politics we will have one man, one value. But in economics and society we won't respect the one man, one value. There will be poor and unpoor, non-poor, and poor will lose their fundamental right because they being poor. And there will be low caste and high caste, and low caste won't be able to enjoy the civic right because they are untouchable. So you need an economic democracy and you need a social democracy. You use that word. For political democracy to be successful, you have to have an economic democracy and social democracy. And that was his warning, which we are experimenting. And you know how social democracy is failed in many respects. Economic democracy failed in many respects. As a result, poor and the caste discriminated people cannot enjoy the democratic and civil right. In fact, in that discussion, he also mentioned that why fascism came in Germany, because economic inequality was its peak. Democracy failed there because economic inequality was immensely high. In Latin American country, economic inequality of a higher order, it's difficult to implement democracy. So for political democracy to be useful, where under which you get a fundamental rights and other right, economic democracy, equality and social equality is must. We accept that, but there is a gap between the practice and the principle. I think, friend, these are the basic ideas of Ambedkar in state and minority, which I have outlined to you. Let's go for a discussion. We have one more hour. Thank you.